like a mountain fly of Japanese can royalties, then where the hell's my royalties? This is Aerosmith. Good evening and welcome to How Profound Can We Be?
At the end of the 80s, the Boston-based band Aerosmith stormed back to the top of the hard rock heap with two powerful albums, Permanent Vacation and Pump. New fans flocked, many of them perhaps unaware that this was a group with nearly 20 years of history behind it. It all started one night back in 1970 when a New York City drummer named Steven Tyler dropped into a club to catch a group called the Jam Band. It was an encounter that changed all of their lives.
I come to find out after I went up and saw Joe Perry and Tom Hamilton in New England playing Rattlesnake Shake that what I was doing all those years was not what it was all about. It was about like letting go and just playing, because those guys couldn't play. They couldn't tune. They were terrible. But they did one song called Rattlesnake Shake and they blew me away. I looked at them and I thought to myself, this is what it's all about. They had such a groove. It stunk from the groove. It was so hot. It was so bad. That I said, if I can take a little bit of what I know from my father and the Dream On type stuff and the melodic stuff and fuse it with their badness, which I come to find out was what it was all about. It's not about practicing. It's not about taking speed and going, it's about letting go and going, dom, dom, bom, dom, 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 when I was a young boy, at the age of five, dom, dom, dom. That's what it's all about.
Well, the music is the music and stuff. I mean, we'd come from it from two different angles. You know, I'm like real energy and like, you know, let's do it now. And let's like, you know, tuning later for that. You know what I mean? Let's just see how loud we can get it, you know, and if it really rocks.
Moved into an apartment together and just did everything together. You know, we got up in the morning and went down to rehearsal, and then in the rehearsal we all went and bought the same kind of beer and ate the same kind of beer nuts and came home at exactly the same time every day and watched the Three Stooges together every day and then started, ate dinner and then rehearsed again all night long.
It was just a question of how long it was going to take. Because if it didn't happen for us when it happened, I think we'd probably still be doing the same thing now as we were doing 20 years ago.
We started out in small gyms. We avoided clubs like the plague. Right from the beginning, we wanted to get used to rooms that were at least bigger than the room at a club.
Mostly, we didn't want to play clubs because we didn't want to have to play other people's material, because the songs you had to play were usually like the top 20, and that's what we avoided. I mean, we played some clubs that let us play our own material, especially after we started, you know, when the first record came out, but for the most part, you had to just go in there and play whatever the top 10 songs were, and we didn't want to do that. I was thinking back to what we used to do is go and promote our own shows. We took it another step. We used to rent the halls ourselves, make our own posters, and run dances.
And when our first record came out, it went up to like about 40,000 units, which accounted for all our New England fans. And then it just stopped selling. And so what do we do? We said, well, we take this little thing that we do and just start pushing it out into the country. And that's what we did. We hit the road. It's like we didn't stop.
We played Ohio.
We didn't stop until like some 1979 or something.
We'll be right back.
working any place, anywhere we could in Boston and the colleges, just to get some money to pay the rent, and doing a lot of dreaming on.
My room at this apartment that we all lived in was basically the living room. I mean, everybody just hung out in my room. My room was the only room big enough to put a piano in. So I woke up every morning to Stephen playing this weird song in the key of F, just telling me how much of a hit it was going to be, and it turned out to be Dream On. Dream On! Dream On! Dream On! Dream yourself a dream come true!
Aerosmith, Get Your Wings. You see that scarf I'm wearing? It was loaded and filled up with two-and-alls and second-alls, which is what I was just getting into during this album. It was the greatest album because one of my favorite all-time songs is on this, called Seasons of Wither, and Train Kept a Rollin'. And same old song and dance.
And of course, this album really, really broke everything wide open. We went out on tour with this album, and all of a sudden we were rock stars.
Ah, this album, Toys in the Attic. We had lots of toys in our attic when we did this album. But you can see we were still holding on to something, and it was the little kid climbing into the pictures with the keys, which we never found. It was somewhere along the last album, which I came to find out that, good God Almighty, bless my soul, I got the right key, baby, but the wrong keyhole. Yes.
They're just a great rock and roll band. I mean, there's always something different coming out of them. You go, wow, that's cool. You know, they're just like the epitome of rock and roll.
I think they are the coolest rock and roll band there is, without a doubt. Aerosmith.
Right behind that glass, right there, getting dressed right now. Can you see them?
Yeah,
look at that.
Gross.
Look, that's what I mean. And we move right on to Rocks. The reason we came up with Rocks is because I couldn't come up with a title. Joe Perry came up with the obvious, as he always does, and says, let's call it Rocks. Because it does. Because it is.
As far as the 70s went, this was the pinnacle as far as Aerosmith's recording technique and how well we were doing, just getting our musical ideas happening and communicating them. Draw the Line was our fifth album. This is when the band finally realized it was successful, and success began to corrupt us a little bit. By this time, we all had our own mansions, you know, Ferraris, Porsches, and all that kind of great stuff.
Draw the Line. This is a great album because we did not know how to draw the line. Perhaps we did on the tabletop, but we're going way past it at this time.
The Night in the Ruts album, the album that broke the band. We got about halfway through this album and had to go back on the road. Our management had gone ahead and booked gigs without leaving us a minute of extra time to finish this record. So, once we got to the... to the end of the basic tracks, we had to put the project down. So we went out on the road. Everybody was extremely burnt out and frustrated because we hadn't finished the record, and that frustration ended up in the band splitting apart.
Aerosmith had become the biggest hard rock band in the land, but by 1979 they were fried from constant touring and deeply into cocaine to keep themselves going. Perry walked away from the group first to form the Joe Perry Project. He was followed in 1980 by guitarist Brad Whitford. Aerosmith replaced them with Jimmy Crespo and Rick Dufay and rocked on as best they could, but the band wasn't the same, and Tyler finally realized exactly what had happened.
I attribute it all to it's all drugs. I would never do that now. What could anybody possibly do to break up a team like Perry and Tyler? What could break us up? What could anyone do? What could he do that would make me think that that I didn't want to write with him? You know, it's like it had to have been the drugs that took its toll. And you know, on one hand, you know, the cocaine made us our army march forward and tour all those times, but look what it did to the band.
And we just took it personally, you know, too personally. We couldn't see it. And, you know, like all of the stuff we were doing to ourselves and all the outside stuff that was going on, the managers and ex-managers and all that, and ex-wives were just piling all the on. And we were just going, well, it must be him. You know, I was going that, it must be Steven. It can't, you know what I mean? And everyone was going, yeah, you don't need him. And I go, okay, yeah, you're right. Well, see you later.
You know, real sad thing if you look back. It's like, okay, history, we had to lose to know how to win and all that stuff. Debatable. But we got a great album out of it. Rockin' the Hard Place Again, real good album, you know. And Joe learned a real, real good lesson, and I learned a real good lesson. You know? Which is, it's not the cough that carries you off, it's the coffin they carry you off in.
After 5 years of flailing away on their own, the original Aerosmith lineup finally drifted back together in 1984, decided to get straight and get serious, and cut a new album called Done With Mirrors. It wasn't the comeback breakthrough they'd hoped for, but it was definitely a declaration of intent.
Somebody had this great idea. Let's print everything on the record backwards. You know, here it is, our first album since getting back together, the album that we're counting on to reestablish us as being back. We've put the band back together. And everything is printed backwards, you know? And one thing, you know, I don't know, it's like, you know, in some ways, it's almost like we were programmed to derail ourselves every once in a while.
Still struggling for a focus in the so far inhospitable 80s, Aerosmith received a phone call one day from a white rap producer named Rick Rubin, a hard rock fan who had an inspiration to cover the Aerosmith classic Walk This Way with a black rap group called Run-DMC, and to invite Aerosmith to join in.
Now looking back at it, it was like a big step, you know what I mean? It was like, seemed like well calculated and all that stuff. You know, Rick Rubin just called up and said, you know, they're going to cover your song, you want to come and sit in on it. You know, it was pretty brilliant on his part, just the getting us to come in there. But that was all it was. We didn't even know what was going on the record. You know, they weren't sure what was going on the record. They had just used the drum parts to rap to, you know, so they figured, well, we'll just cover the song.
Back in the day, we used to rock off just the beginning part. Jay used to scratch it. Isk at at
isk
at at da 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 at
no just
da 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 at at and then we go da 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 vuka vuka vuka
isk
at.
Good thing they asked Joe to bring his guitar, because you know he played the guitar, and I went in and sang it first for them, and it was a marriage of the two, so it worked so well. Plus, you know, I have such a hatred about the black-white thing, you know, and the way it is in America, that anything to break down the walls a little, you know, I would do just about anything, you know, to try to show that there's nothing really there, and if there is, it's just ignorance, you know, it's behind it all.
They're definitely one of the best bands around. I think we're one of the few bands that like them but don't sound like them, you know? I mean, yeah. Everybody seems to try and copy them, which is obviously the ultimate flattery for them, you know? I mean, there's a lot of bands now that all sound like Aerosmith, you know? So, I mean, they've been so influential.
Hard Rock, and in comes 5,000 kids, Aerosmith, the mayor, and this guy with the big lips gets up and says, I'm glad I got a chance to put my bologna in the Aerosmithsonian. And they sit back and order dessert. That's what kind of day it's been.
Well, actually, this Aerosmithsonian was at our last rehearsal hall. That's when we first coined it, because the roadies would fill up the road boxes with all the ladies' underwear and bras and stuff that would be thrown on the stage through the course of the tour. And then at the rehearsal hall, they would put it up there and we'd walk in every day and there'd be more and more of it as they would pull it out of the road boxes. And that's when we started calling it the Aerosmithsonian.
Besides, it's better to see my permanent vacation suit on the wall at the Hard Rock than down at Goodwill on some bum.
Permanent Vacation was the album that brought Aerosmith back as a major hard rock force. All of a sudden, they found themselves being honored for their longevity, their survival, and of course, for their music. There remained only one new skill to master, and that was video. Aerosmith got so into it that they wound up documenting the entire making of their next LP, Pump, on tape.
The hardest part was when we were writing down in Cohasset here, because like when we'd be writing the songs, David would be there with the camera, but we got used to it after a while. You know, I mean, he got a lot of good footage of some stuff. You know, I'm kind of worried. You know, I mean, there's some stuff in there. You know, when we get together and start in on somebody, or that something's screwed up. He's got some great footage of some arguments amongst the band and stuff that, you know, I thought that we would never let happen. But you know, looking back, I think it's really cool that he got it. But a couple of songs in particular, I know he's got Elevator from the time I walked in with the riff, you know, to the time Stephen put the last vocal on. I mean, he's got footage of the whole thing.
Now I know why I'm not sitting at the drums, because you're in the way. Would you like to move? What was Daddy really like?
You know, when you're a little kid, you know how you go, oh, if this was a movie now, I would.
Yeah, right.
Well, here we are.
No shit. Well, I think that if we scrutinize and take this apart anymore, we'll have nothing! Hold that part, will ya? We'll go straight. Nobody gets out alive. Okay, yeah, punch her into that. Stuck! Nobody gets out alive! Then I show you how to fax in the back room, honey! She said, it's alive. I'll show you how to fax. I'll show you how to fax in the mail room, honey! Just go ahead. She said, I'll show you how to fax in the mail room, honey! And have your home by fax! And have your home by fax! Loving it and loving it, when I'm going down. Loving it and loving it.
album was, it was a lot of work, physically, mentally, and emotionally to do this record. We worked our asses off on this one.
Individually and together, when we work as a team, that's what this record is all about, because it's just such a team effort. And, I mean, we really busted our nuts to do this record. It's the sound of my gun. Girl, now, honey, what are you doing? Girl, now, it's the sound.
You know, everybody's, you know, can do stuff on their own, but that's what makes Aerosmith the strength that it is. It's like five guys like stepping on each other's toes, you know, and making sure that it, you know, no one screws up too bad.
It's just the greatest thing to be able to do this for a living. It's just the greatest. This, I feel like after 20 years, this is the fantasy fulfillment.
To have it again and have it bigger than it was before. There is justice. Someone up there likes us.
Never lose sight that we're a band together, you know, and it's like, that's the way we shall always stay.
On that note, we will cut and change tape.
Is that right?
How'd you know that?
I don't know. I just kind of feeling.